Hello, everybody, and welcome to the MBS Show Reviews. This is James Cork, and with me I have Norman Sanso.
You saw me in episode 10. I was in the background.
Okay. Awesome, Brony reviewer Silverquill.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. I like to think I live in the foreground of life.
And his army of fanboys, apparently. Awesome, Brony reviewer Sketchy the Changeling.
That changeling at the wedding was not me. Let's just get that out right there.
Lies.
That is good to know. That is good to know. And fantastic head of the Highland Bronies group, Diane Sugardoff.
Hi! I heard the word Dr. Hooves.
And you heard it right. And in case you didn't know, we are reviewing episode 9 of season 5, overall episode 100, written by M.A. Larson, titled Slice of Life. So, in this episode, we have Cranky Doodle Donkey and Matilda from all the way to, it was a friend indeed, if I recall correctly, preparing their wedding. And as they are preparing the invitations, they realize that the date is set incorrectly and everybody thinks that the wedding is on the day that they are right now, instead of tomorrow. So they have to rush, they have to move the entire wedding as the main six fight a monster that is attacking Ponyville. Now, this is an interesting episode, and as you may have noticed, we have quite a crowd to review it right now. So, we're going to be talking about it, we're going to be discussing what it entails, what it means for this, not just for the series, but for this fandom, to have 100 episodes of this TV show that we all love and adore so much. So, we're going to follow with the usual inverted alphabetical order. So this time, because we have more people, it's going to be Sugardoff, then Sketchy, then Silver, then Norman, and finally I will give my 2 cents. So, Sugardoff, what did you think of this episode?
So many fangirl squeeze. I don't think I've ever sat down and made so many squeaking noises in my entire life. Like, the second Doctor Who's appeared on screen, that was the end of all my thought processing. It was, oh, they're using a cool voice actor. Oh, he said the thing! He said the thing! All my headcanons are intact!
It's a big feat considering how many headcanons got destroyed because of this episode.
I've never had a headcanon before now, and I'm sitting there going, oh, Doctor Who's is wide open! Keeping him! Keeping him!
And what about you, Sketchy? What do you think of the episode?
There were definitely parts that I did like, but there was also a lot of stuff that just didn't sit well with me. So, like, if I had to, like, put, like, a percentage or something, I would say probably 30% I liked it, and then the other 70% was just either indifferent or just didn't like it.
Wow. That is... Wow. Okay. Well, I hope that 70% didn't ruin the episode entirely.
Oh, well. In some ways, yes. In other ways, no.
Oh, dear.
Like, it didn't, it wasn't very memorable for me either, to be completely honest.
No, that's fine. That's fine. We're gonna have the voice of dissent in here. Well, who knows? And what about you, Silver? What do you think of the episode?
There's your voice of dissent. Yeah. Okay. Satanic possession.
Yes.
How is this? Okay, I maintain a same philosophy I had for Rainbow Rocks. I apply to Slice of Life. A shout out to the fandom in any visual or scenic form is fun. It's like a secret language. The audience feels, hey, I got that. I'm in on the joke. That can make it fun. It can't make an episode good on its own. So I'm very thankful that I thought this was also a good episode because it keeps in mind the three audiences that are watching this show. There's the kids, the intended audience. There's the bronies, the unexpected audience. And the audience we never really seem to talk about, the parents. those folks who are not bronies, they're not participating online, but I hope they're watching this show with their kids and making sure their kids are consuming the right kind of media.
Yeah, the kind of that doesn't send a bad message, that is not poorly put together, and that it's appropriate for them to watch.
So, truth be told, I want to talk about, like, each arc, each, you know, they're all little vignettes. Each vignette, some of them are purely brony shout-outs.
Yes.
Whereas others could be viewed by a parent with no knowledge and still be enjoyable. And then there's the pure story of mostly revolving around Cranky and Matilda's wedding. So all in all, I enjoyed this episode. I will agree that there were some parts that were more, that's just for the fans, and the other two audiences are going to suffer for it.
Well, of course, there is no episode without its flaws, and we're going to see it in, we're going to see it right away as we get into it. And finally, what did you think of the episode, Norman?
I have a policy starting from the beginning of this season not to spoil myself by watching trailers and whatnot. And when this popped up on my Facebook feed, EQD, I just couldn't stop myself. So I just watched the first trailer. Watching Derpy talk made me go ballistic. I was squeeing hype, like, how do I put this? I couldn't believe they did that. And I stopped from that point on, like, okay, no more, no more. There's no more spoiling beyond this point. I want to stay pure. So overall, when I saw this, it was a whole of, oh my God, they actually did this? This is just insane. And before this episode came out, we talked to Larson, and he told us that it was a bad idea for them to do it, but Hasbro said, just do it. And, and well, this is the result. I am shocked. You, James, what about you?
Well, how to put it in words without actually sweating or going fanboy with it? This is the first TV show in Hasbro's lineup of toy-based or TV shows with a toy line that actually reaches over 100 episodes. The very first one. Not G.I. Joe, not the original Transformers, not the original MLP. No other TV show has managed to reach 100 episodes before this one. This episode is a celebration of everything that this show is and what this fandom, as crazy and insane as it is, has managed to achieve over the years. It has big, big problems every now and then. Not enough to ruin the whole experience, but the thing is that I really don't care about these problems. I don't care because everything else is so, there is so much love thrown into this episode. Both to the show and to the fandom. And to me that is brilliant. That is worth respecting. So yeah, you know what? I don't want to call it best episode of the season, but they raised the bar too high. I really wonder how are they going to surpass what this episode managed to achieve. Let's hope they didn't blow their load way too early.
Well, when they have the pony zombie apocalypse led by Starlight Glimmer in the finale, I'm sure that you'll reconsider your opinion. Oh, was that a spoiler?
Oh, no.
That can be a spoiler because if you consider the list of episodes that was leaked a few months ago, so far every single title has been correct. So who knows? Maybe that will happen.
Oh, no.
Although you're misleading them, Silver. It's not zombies. It's vampires. Don't lie to the audience.
No, I will have no vampires near my sparkle.
I don't blame you.
We already have Splatterpot anyway, so.
And we will again. By the way, Norman, I just want to say, if you want to stay pure, you shouldn't hang out with me.
First mistake, I know.
I'm making the right.
I thought you were going to say you shouldn't hang out with Sketchy just because I'm a changeling.
Oh, that's speciesist. I think we learned from this episode that changelings can be very well behaved. But pony prejudice runs deep.
You know what I didn't see in the background, however? Griffons. They were all still trying to reconstruct their city.
Okay, I've got my own views on Griffinstone, but basically, I'm glad to be a horse's ass. In fact, speaking of asses, let's talk about kissing asses.
Oh, yeah, let's talk about that. And
We shall follow
like going through the arcs, like Silver said. So yeah, let's talk about the beginning of the episode, because so we see how Cranky and Matilda, they continued with their daily life, and how they are still together, and that is such a neat thing to see. I mean, I've been missing these two guys since season two. What do you think?
Other than the fact that I'm a woman, so I'm automatically drawn to cute things, and I thought they were adorable, my main click when I was watching them was going, how on earth did they get all of these photo bombs and no pony realize? Like, of all the things for me to pick up on, it's like, adorable couple, but how did they pull off that photo?
Oh, they're experts. Haven't you seen that one with Mystery on the what Express Train episode?
Friendship.
Yeah, Mystery on the Friendship Express. Yeah, have you seen that mule? That was a ninja, yo.
That was make believe. But considering that people are not looking at the background characters, of course we might miss them.
Yeah, the mules just want you to think that was reality. Pinky actually uncovered the ninja mule conspiracy. they are all one clan.
Now we just have to find their hideout.
And it is good to see that Cranky is still as cranky as usual, and Matilda is as sweet as ever. I mean, these two are meant for each other. Like, he is super, super rude, and he is super rude, and she is super kind. She compliments him.
Yeah, like, she's lots of fun, he's no fun at all, so she literally completes him.
Yay, Ice Age!
Someone got it, finally, yes.
I was trying to make that reference, but I didn't know how that sentence worked in English.
Oh, boy.
I'm surprised I remember the movie, considering how long it's been since I saw it.
Wow.
Oh, focus. We need to talk about the episode. Come on, guys.
I don't know. I mean, with this one, I never thought that I just never thought that they would go for this approach. Like, approach this couple and start off another wedding. Because we remember the last wedding that happened, right?
This one was better.
Yeah, but...
Excuse me?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes, I'm going there.
Controversy!
I am placing Cranky and Matilda over Cadence and Shining Armor, and you can't stop me.
I actually, wow. You know what? As much as I like Cadence and Shining Armor, I agree with the Hippogriff. I think this...
Y'all are just breaking my heart right now.
Not really, because these guys have, I think, go ahead, Silver, go and give your opinion. Why did you think that Cranky and Matilda have a lot more going for them than Cadence and Shining?
Well, first off, don't go breaking my heart, Miss Sketchy. Yeah. Here's the thing. One, I'm not a big fan of the first episode of A Canterlot Wedding. Everything enjoyable about that two-parter was in part two in my eyes. But here's the thing. When Cadence and Shining Armor hit the scene, here are these new characters. They love each other so much. It's a love that can move mountains. Hi, nice to meet you. and I'm sitting there going, wait, what? Who are these ponies? Where did they come from? Why have they not been here? They're related to Twilight? What? What? And I'm just so busy trying to figure out these characters. I'm like, I'm not invested in them. I don't know them enough to care that they're getting married. I want to know them as characters. Cranky and Matilda, we know them from a past episode. We know that Cranky searched Equestria to find her and that she really needs to work on her note placement. So we're taking a previous element and building off of it, which they do several times in this episode. And I think that's really well done. That's what I wish Cadence and Shining Armor could have enjoyed, an introductory episode followed by their wedding. And let's face it, though their wedding was not on the scale of Cadence and Shining Armor, it certainly went smoother, showed sort of how everyone has their own story, and even the changeling, singular, was better behaved than her, its brethren.
No, I'll admit, they were wilding out a little bit at Cadence with Wayne, yeah.
Basically, what you're saying is that Cranky's and Matilda's relationship has a better build-up, and they have better chemistry than Cadence and Shining. And I absolutely agree with you on that one.
If by better build-up you mean any build-up, I just... Where?
I will definitely concede that point with you.
This one wins by default. By the way, yes, a Canterlot Wedding Part 1 can go rot in hell. That episode is terrible.
Let's not go that far.
Yeah. I'm sketchy here. Look,
that episode is so infuriating. I'm not going to talk about that one. But
No. We're not going to review past episodes. But no, I still haven't finished what I was going to say.
I don't want to set something on fire. Go ahead. No,
the thing about this episode, what I like about... Well, the setup for this marriage or this wedding was, it's much better in terms of, okay, it ran smoothly as possible, being there's a bugbear attack and the background characters are doing most of the job pretty well. Canterlot Wedding, okay, we are going to have everything go smoothly. Suddenly we have a wedding crasher by the bride herself. What's going on? That's the fun part, but hey, we're not going to review that one, right? So, love this wedding. It's so much fun. The ending there was good, but when we reach there, we reach there.
Then we realize that, of course, the invitations are written incorrectly. Instead of saying the wedding is tomorrow, the wedding is set to today. So they have to move everything forward. And we then realize that Cranky is a cheap donkey. He is a cheap ass.
To be fair, I was the same for my wedding. Cheap as humanly possible.
Oh, well, you're Scottish. You cannot help that. So.
Oh, Gene, Sweetie Boy is going to have fun on this episode.
And like that.
No one disses a Scots woman. Thank you.
Oh, what are you going to do about it? Attack me with a bagpipe?
I'm sorry. You're coming to which convention this year?
I'm prepared for the fight. I'm going to get my ass handed to me.
Get it,
ass, because you're talking about donkeys.
James, I will make a video for your funeral.
Oh, that would be worth it.
I hope you like haggis.
I will die a hero.
To be fair, I don't like haggis.
with regards to the opening scene where we see Cranky and Matilda getting ready for their wedding. Mm-hmm. I'm definitely going to agree with Silver Quill in the fact that their relationship definitely has more grounding and you can get a lot more invested in their romance compared to Shining Armor and Cadence. And that's one of the flaws about that episode that I will definitely concede. And here, I think this is a really strong point in Slice of Life where we get to revisit a couple that we saw seasons earlier. We can see that they're still going strong, and like out of all the couples, like Shining Armor and Cadence, the Cakes, like these are the two. This is the one couple where we actually have the most knowledge of them as far as their connection to each other is concerned.
I disagree. I think you see more of the Cakes. I think you see more of the Cakes for the fact that they have children, that they run a business, and that they are friends with one of the main six, and they live with her. I think that you see more of the Cakes than you have seen of Matilda and Cranky, and you cannot argue against that. There are more episodes featuring the Cakes than there are of featuring
Cranky. Yeah, they're in more episodes, but I feel that with Cranky and Matilda's romance, like as far as their connection to each other and how much they mean to each other, I feel like I know more about that than I do with the Cakes. Because like, okay, yeah, they have children. Yeah, one of the main six works with them. But like, we don't really know much about, like we do see that they work well together, but we don't really see much of, I'm not trying to bash their relationship or anything, but I think that Cranky and Matilda's, as far as our knowledge goes on their, how they got to be together and their history with each other, I think we have more knowledge on that. And therefore, I feel as though their relationship is a lot more resonant.
Yeah, I do agree with you there, because you have the trial and tribulations of Cranky Doodle trying to find Matilda from every spot in Equestria, from beginning with hair and
going
bald. Hang
on a minute, Norman. Go ahead, Silver, you were going to say.
Well, I actually think I was going to mirror Norman's thoughts. This is really probably the best example of Love Conquers All, because, okay, no disrespect to the love-fueled shockwave. That was woo! But a year-long struggle, and he never gave up looking for her until the very end, where, thank goodness, he actually found her. That does speak very powerful to the strength of their relationship and how much they care for one another. And I made a video gushing about the cakes, so I don't dismiss them, but they've also enjoyed a more stable time together than Cranky Matilda. So it's kind of that balancing point. You have an act of love on par, in my eyes, with Cadence and Shining Armor, but with a more prolonged struggle.
Definitely.
And also, I think that the cakes here, we are not given any backstories to them, how they fall in love or how they found each other. We just got a story of, hey, they're together. They're the bakers in this town. If you want cake, go to them. Yay. While Cranky and Matilda here, we saw their struggles. If you don't mind me going to the comics, if we saw the issue of Shining Armor and Cadence of how they met, I think that would have been a better introduction for those two to get to, well, know them and feel for them, but
definitely,
since we got them in the comics, it doesn't really count.
Yes, just for the show, just from what we see on the show, we don't see enough of Cadence and Shining to grant all these fairy tale story kind of love story.
Yeah, if this kind of element has been introduced prior.
You know what? I'm going to draw a parallel between, because we're basically talking Disney team right now. This is like comparing the love story between Snow White and the Prince to the story at the beginning of Up. Okay? Like, because, yeah, what Cranky and Matilda have going on, from the beginning of that episode of A Friend Indeed, I was having a very strong Up vibe, especially because of the attitude that Cranky had. Thank goodness that there was no dead fiancé at the end of that episode. I mean, I cannot take that much drama when it comes to this cartoon. But that's probably the one reason why this relationship may be stronger. Is because we have had a lot more information about it. But
true.
Yes. So...
Would that make Pinkie Pie Russell, though?
Most likely. So we do have... I was talking about how you can see that Cranky is very cheap when it comes to the invitations and all that. Because he's like, I got a very good deal out of you, and now you send all the wrong invitations to everybody. Cut to every single fan out there losing their heads.
Well, okay, wow, we're going to lose Norman. I think his head's going to go scanners on us.
Well, we can always recover him later.
If he dies, can I take his show?
I think you already have.
But, yeah. You're still alive, right?
Oh, can you hear something? I don't hear anything.
I don't hear anything either. Right. But, yeah, so we have the introduction of Derpy in the probably best way possible, because, I mean, don't they both confirm at the same time that she both likes muffins and she works on the post office?
Yes.
Because she did deliver all the invitations. How else will she deliver the invitations other than her being a male mare?
Oh, wow. So much. But, wow.
Oh, but to go to the three audiences argument, this is kind of going to be my thing. If you didn't know anything about this show, if you weren't part of the fandom, if you were a parent watching, or a kid who just doesn't go online, those exist, right?
I guess.
That joke would have fallen flatter than a pancake. Because you're like, muffin? Okay, why a muffin?
Well, from my point of view here, as a person outside looking into this, the muffin symbolizes, sorry, would you like a muffin? Kind of deal. And I like what they do after this, where she explains herself to an unknown and talk about how she messed up.
Dairy,
yeah, but it's half a joke. I think what Silver is saying is that Yeah, that can be fun, but it's like you only have half the information. If you want to understand the whole joke, you'll need to go on the internet and find out, oh, yes, this character apparently likes muffins according to the fandom because of this, because of episode 4 of season 1 that aired all the way back in 2010.
Even though she
wasn't the one saying the word muffins.
What I'm trying to say here is, as a person looking outside, that information from what I process is, okay, this gray pony here, is just saying sorry because she messed up. And offers a muffin.
We didn't hear you say anything about this event, Sketchy. What do you think?
I think that they would kind of be gotten it. I think people would have gotten the joke because like she presented them in a basket. So it's like, oh, she's like trying to say sorry. Like those type of apology things. Like if you send a complaint to a company, they'll send you a nice little care package with a nice little basket. So it's like, yeah. I could kind of see people getting it. Of course, it'll be more resonant to people who actually are in on the joke, but...
Mm-hmm. Here, I thought this was going to be one of those moments that will make you rage. Yes, Silver, go ahead.
It'll just
Hang on a minute, Sketch. Go ahead, Silver.
Yeah, sure.
Just to get the full extent of this joke, you must interact with an online fandom.
Never.
Very much so, very much so. I wouldn't put it any other way, actually.
You mean there's more of us?
No, there's like, interacting with an online fandom is always terrifying.
Oh, yes.
Because you don't know what you're going to say that is going to trigger somebody. Intro, all that. Funny enough, they didn't change the intro. I thought they were going to change the intro for this episode. I'm kind of glad they didn't. We cut to Derpy talking with someone that we don't see as they are discussing that the invitations were sent incorrectly. And that individual is none other than the doctor.
The voice actor and everything.
Who is voiced by Peter New, actually, doing his best to do a David Tennant impression. It is clear that they're going for the David Tennant Doctor. So, guys, we have Doctor Hoofs on the show. Like, and not only that, but he's talking with Derpy. All those radio shows with Doctor Hoofs an assistant, where Derpy is the assistant and all that. Now all of that is kind of canon? Because these guys interact like they have been friends forever. Mm-mm. I mean, what do you guys think about this? And as always, we need to hear the opinion of the Doctor Who's.
Like, everything he said was marvelous because they kept intact the integrity of the fan character while, like, just as soon as you see his space, that just confirms so many questions I would have had. It's like, they made it look like it should be that. They made it look like it should be the TARDIS without it actually looking like a TARDIS. They made it sound like he knew technology. They made it sound like science was his passion. They had the clever thing of going, that traumatic event, leaving so many headcanons open. It's like they left the opportunity there for us to play with the character. And like, it's like, there's an open opportunity being left for us to enjoy. And I'm like, this is so cool. This was all I needed in the episode. I would have quite happily ended the episode right there. So I was like, right, that's all of my headcanons done. I am happy. I can leave a happy fangirl. Sitting here making squee noises on my couch.
Like, something tells me you are biased. I'm not sure. I have the bye for something.
I have plenty of opinions on the rest of the characters that come up in this episode, but because he was my primary concern, I was like, I knew he was coming, and it was like, oh, please let them do it right. Oh, please let them do it right. If they're going to shout out my fandom, let them do it right. And they did. They did a good job. They didn't cross any lines to hurt the BBC, and they kept the integrity of the idea intact. And I was like, right, you've made me happy. You've left it open for me. I'm quite just going to leave you there in the happy corner.
Okay, and what do you think, Sketchy?
I was less concerned with hearing a doctor speak. I was like, oh yeah, the doctor speaks. Oh, that's cool. But I was like more concerned with the conversation they were having. Like, see, so they're friends. And Derpy is saying, oh my god, what am I gonna do? How am I gonna fix this? And then the doctor is now trying to help her come up with a solution to the problem. So I was like, okay, this looks cool. Let's see where we go with this.
Here's the thing. If you're a brony, you're squeeing at this scene. You're just like, oh my gosh. And they even throw in Space Cadet Derpy just for, oh, sorry. Should I call her the Muffin Mayor now?
Oh yeah. No, just call her Derpy. We don't
care. We're going to call her Derpy. Yeah.
Well, apparently she's named Muffin now.
Mm-hmm. You know, she is. We should discuss the name character, the names of the characters after the episode's over.
In later. But, you look at this, and if you're a Doctor Who fan, you'll say, hey, that kind of looks like a TARDIS. But this is back to the three audiences. For parents who aren't Whovians, aren't bronies, this guy is just a mad scientist. And it works. Mm-hmm. This is a joke that works on all three audiences. A fun, eccentric personality, a guy who can remind you of the Doctor or can just be a mad doctor, mm-hmm. has his own little backstory. I've actually, I think M.A. Larson released some background information on development. Ooh, that traumatic childhood experience he referenced was a bowling tournament.
Okay.
That's why he's so squeamish about doing the bowling.
Well, that's what he says. I mean, I'm of the mind that if you have to look up on Twitter to find out about an episode, it's not a good episode. But this was more just fun little ideas that didn't quite make it in.
Mm.
But
yeah, there were some ideas that didn't make it in. But yeah, go ahead, Silver.
And, there's one. Oh, yes. Here's, when people say, oh, this show is aimed at girls, there's plenty of boys entertainment, you don't need enjoyable male characters, I will point to a good doctor. And I will just say, nah-uh. He helped make this episode. And he wasn't stealing the spotlight. He didn't diminish anyone else. But I just can't stand it when people make that argument any more than I can stand when people say girls don't have any role in a boys' show.
Actually, you know what? You bring a very interesting point, because this episode does have a good balance between male and female characters. I mean, shall we count Stephen Magnett as male? We
yes.
should, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's just fabulous.
I'm sure.
But,
I'm sure.
Okay.
I'm going to count him as a jerk face.
Oh, we're going to touch that
well,
when we get to that. We're going to touch that when we get to that. But like, this episode does have a good balance between male and female characters. Much better than some episodes of previous seasons. Because suddenly you have same amount for both genders. And I think that is good. I think that is very fair.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to see that more often in this show.
Every show.
Mm-hmm. True. Mm-hmm. I was thinking from the aspect of, okay, I enjoyed the whole scene with the Doctor. I was queen like Sugar was, because I too love Doctor Who. And everything they did here was, oh my god, this is so good. Everything was, in terms of fandom, it kept it whole. In terms of Doctor Who, they had everything right without being sued by BBC. And everything was perfect. But from an outsider looking inside, I could have, how do I put this? Just playing devil's advocate here. I could just say that if this was not in, it could have worked better, but then we don't have the fireless fireworks, something like that? Those, what you call, those flowers that look like,
Yeah, they do bring up the fireless fireworks, yeah, which are gonna have a play on the episode.
Yeah, so that's there, so that needs to be there, just for setup. So, it's kind of hard for me to say, this is not needed, but it is for the setup. So, what Silver said earlier does work for this scene. But I'm still pondering, like, if I was an outsider looking at this, would it still work or not?
Norman, are you pondering what I'm pondering?
What are you pondering?
I'm pondering that you haven't watched Pinky and the Brain, and I am so
I'm trying to do, but I forgot the line.
Stop pondering and start pandering anyway.
Oh, boy.
Stop pandering, please.
The Doctor loses focus.
Pandas
on that,
everywhere.
And he realizes that his outfit is not ready for the wedding.
Mm-hmm.
So he rushes to have Rarity fix it, but she's nowhere to be seen. She's not at the boutique. And decides to ask none other than Vinyl Scratch for help.
Oh, boy. I do like the detail here where Doctor Who goes to Rarity. Like, Rarity is the only tailor in town.
Usually, when it comes to small towns, you always have one of everything. Like one Taylor, one Baker, one bowling alley, one everything. You only have one of everything. So why do you need more? Besides, come on, Grundy. but not being rated, rating not being around, he asks Bionel for help. And I love the idea of Bionel going around, just bobbing her head up and down, listening to music. And because she doesn't get all the information proper, she takes him to the bowling alley, where he meets with the Lebowski ponies. Let's talk about the Lebowski ponies for a moment, okay? Jeff Bridges is a pony. Yes, please, more. If somebody should be ponified, that should be Jeff Bridges. What do you guys think?
I don't know what to think.
Okay, sketchy. Okay, Silver.
Okay. So,
No, you lost your turn, like, Sketchy. Silver, your turn.
Oh, come on, be nice.
What?
Yeah, I'm joking.
Yes, lose, you lose.
All right. So, okay, this was that point where I'm like, wait, what are we doing here? Like, that was like when that warning signal went off in my head, because everything leading up to this, like, yeah, I can get behind this. Like, going back to Silver Quill's point on him being a mad scientist and having that be appealing to all three audience and therefore it works. Yeah, I think that was a really cool thing to do so that everybody could be included. And I was rolling along with it. I was really liking what they were doing. And then we get to the bowling alley and then we just start to lose focus a little bit. And it's like, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? So I wasn't too enthralled by the whole bowling alley scene at all, to be honest.
I was caught off guard by that until I realized, I had to watch it twice to realize what I'd missed, is because I had watched Final Scratch's speech, is how she's interpreting what others around her are saying. She's not listening to anyone, but interpreting gestures and lip movements, and the fact that all she picked up on was the round shape and went, bowling alley. And I'm like, how did I not make that connection between her assuming the circle and the bowling alley? It's like, it took me a few takes to realize the joke, and I was like, oh, okay, now I get the joke. But what on earth are these ponies saying? Like, the only thing about this scene that I actually liked was the joke about, what is this man? I'm like, that's a good point. That's a really good point. You're saying, what, man? What, the... Like, I had no idea what was going on. This whole scene threw me totally off guard. It's like, what? Why is there even, like, the language was weird. Like, how would you even make the association with bowling alley in the first place?
Okay. And what do you think, Silver?
Well, like, that's just your opinion, man.
Good answer.
Well, going off Sketchy here, this is a little unique because I don't think this was for bronies. This was for parents, much as the original Lebowski cameo and The One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and James Bond and Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas and all that other, all these other references that little kids.
Oh my God, I'm so young.
Should not.
Yeah, you are. You're showing that.
Hush, youngin'. All these references that have been in there is sort of that tried and true philosophy is that Walt Disney said, if you aim just for kids, you're dead. You've got to throw some stuff in for the grown-ups to enjoy. And those scenes throughout the series were for the parents watching with their kids. We bronies were a happy beneficiary. Hmm. Happy beneficiary, I'll say. But yeah, a quinky dink. So having them come back, I've never known the brony fandom to be like super engaged with these three characters. They were there, we noted it, but I haven't seen, like, you know, big comics and fanfics about them. This was for the parents saying, hey guys, we remember you. Here's some pop culture references for something you may recognize. And bronies, of course, we're going to go gaga for it. Hmm. Oh my God, it's Lebowski Pony! Kids, I think this one's going to go over their head because they're not really getting what it's about and you don't know why they're saying man. It's an eh moment in terms of the two out of three audiences.
And what do you
Good
think
to know me and Sketchy are on the same page here. We missed the reference.
What did you think, Norman?
Me, knowing what Big Lebowski is, I'm in the camp of the parent. I know who they are. I know what they do. They play bowling and they get into some massive trouble. If you just look at the cutie mark, there's a rug for the Lebowski pony. So yeah.
His cutie mark is a carpet. Yeah. It ties the pony so well together.
Yeah. So for me, this made sense for me. But in terms of the bigger, broader picture, in what the whole setup here was, Doctor Who wanted to get his coat done, but Remedy's not there, asking help from Vinyl. Vinyl misinterpreting what the Doctor's saying and brought him to the bowling alley. And then the Doctor even said that, why did you bring me here? Rarity would never step hoof in this place. Looking at the three guys, the Lebowskis, he noticed, hey, probably they know where to find another tailor in town. And he asked, they responded, and saying, help us win, I'll alter that shirt for you or jacket for you. And that's the whole deal. And so, in terms of a nutshell in story, done.
Okay.
Yeah, done.
All I'll say is this. This is a scene where Doctor Who goes to the Big Lebowski characters to ask for a tailor for his suit being made, and they ask him to compete on a bowling alley in pony format.
Yeah, true that.
That's insane that this happened, and it's awesome.
So true.
But yeah, I can see how that's, not to repeat what Silver said, but it is a clear reference to anyone who grew up and watched these movies during the 90s. Mm-hmm. I mean, come on. Big Lebowski is one of those films that when it first came out, it didn't do very well, but now it has become a cult classic.
Yep. Oh, by the way, the mathematical thing that the Doctor sees in the bowling alley, somebody did that and most of
Soul
that...
Gibberish.
Yeah. No, most of that is true. Like,
really?
Yeah, like you got force diagram, linear velocity, Newton's second law, torque, angular velocity.
I subscribe.
See, I would have been one of those.
Oh wow! That's what happens when I talk math.
I love math. It's brilliant.
Sorry, you're back in school again. Looks like we're back in school again.
I'll probably try and link it in the show. But yeah, somebody on the DeviantArt just listed down everything that's right with this.
We don't care. Let's move on to the next scene. So
I haven't seen math like this since the Sonic Rainboom incident.
Oh, wow.
Somebody worked it out. Oh, it's Jesus. Crazy.
I don't know. We are a fandom with plenty of math fanatics. I guess I'm just not one of them.
So true.
So we step out of the bowling alley and right on the outside, and we see that an audience has gathered around the main six who are discussing something that we cannot hear. And the Cutie Mark Crusaders and Octavia are there around wondering what is going on, what are they talking about. Well, maybe it's a friendship problem and it can be solved in like 30 minutes or something like that. As Sweetie Belle says while taking the lampshade off of her head. This is the introduction of the bugbear, the panda bear, the panda bug, whatever it's called, the monster.
Bugbear.
It's a panda ring. Anyway.
Well, it's pandaing for the audience.
Yeah, it definitely is.
Pandas everywhere.
True.
It happens right when Matilda is trying to look for the arrangements for the wedding. So, we haven't heard Tabby, Octavia talk until this moment, and I don't count the Rainbow Rocks cameo she had. I mean, talking in pony form. This is the first time she speaks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That marks at least to me, it's fairly important because, I mean, come on, Tabby, she's awesome, best background character. But what did you guys
yes.
think of this one scene? What did you think of it? Super.
I'm coming out of Doctor Who mode. Hang on.
Well, in that case,
this is where I go back to being a normal brony, because now I have my other fandoms out of my face. It's great. I can calm down and focus on something else. But I do like that there are cameos. I love there are cameos. I love hearing the voices. But it's like, all of a sudden we're like, oh, here's the options, a monster or a friendship problem. Well, I wonder what that's going to be. And the second the monster appears on the screen, my brain's going, really? Is this a Dungeons & Dragons reference, or am I missing something here? Like Bugbear? Bugbear,
well,
really?
We have seen all bears in the comics, and Dungeons & Dragons being owned by Hasbro anyway, so, yeah.
I mean, it's an unusual shout-out. I was like, I'm not, at first I was a little surprised, I was like, oh yeah, I remember that these are things that I should be remembering about Hasbro, that they do have other things to bring into the show, and I'm like, oh, okay, I respect you've done that reference, but I was so not expecting that. It's like I was just waiting for the cameos from here on out that I was totally thrown off by lots of the little details. Like, when we go on to talk about the other ponies as well, I know we will. Like, there were so many little things that I was not expecting from Hasbro. And it's like, this is one of these moments where I was like, oh, that's from that thing. I did not see that coming. It was refreshing to see things that I wasn't expecting of a pony show. And Tavi does have a lovely voice.
And what do you think, Sketch?
I'm not missing my turn this time. I thought it was cool that they gave like a reason for the main six to be occupied. So it's like, oh, they're off doing something else. Let's focus on these guys. So I thought that it was real. Like, I've seen it in other shows before, but I can't pick and choose a certain example to use. But I thought it was really cool that they did that. And hearing Octavia's voice was the moment where I gave into my inner fanboy because. Like you, James, I think she is best background pony. Like, she is bae. And hearing her, I really like the voice that they gave her. And it made me look forward to the problem that she was going to have trying to get ready for the wedding. And let me just put it out there right now. I would like to sleep on a bed made of her voice.
Oh, okay, that's a fetish if I ever seen one. They did make her sound classy without make her sound snobbish.
Mm-hmm. At least from
what I'm seeing. It's British American. Yes.
I was kind of thrown off. I was like, I'm not sure if she's meant to sound exotic or not.
It's Bremerican. It's a mixture of British and American. It's a
Bremerican.
That's a thing.
It was odd because being British myself, it's like she doesn't quite sound British posh, but she doesn't quite sound
American. She doesn't sound American either.
It's like I was half expecting something like Russian or like some European mixed language. I wasn't expecting. Well, I don't
Russian,
know. Like it's
what?
She sounds beautiful.
Oh, you were expecting her to sound like the heavy from TF2.
No.
Who talks my cello?
I expected something more exotic from her. So it was really odd. I mean, she sounds beautiful, but the accent was totally not what I expected.
I think we've been spoiled by the fandom because of our talented VAs, fan VAs that is. We're spoiled. But Silver, what do you think, man?
Yeah, what do you think, Silver?
You made it weird, Sketchy. Why'd you have to make it weird? Stop making it weird.
Of course. My mere presence makes it weird already.
Alright, here's my question. How cynical do you have to be that suddenly an attack by a giant flying panda with a stinger? It's just a mild inconvenience. I mean, we've reached City of Townsville levels. Ponyville's been destroyed so many times, it's on par with South Park. And now these days, you mentioned Dungeons and Dragons. Well, I've often wondered, you know, you see two old ladies sitting on their porch. Oh, have you seen young Billy lately? Oh, he forgot his cloak of invisibility and got devoured by a dreammonger, don't you know? Oh, that's a shame. And he just survived the Wendigo attack.
Well, as we're going to see on a scene that is coming up very soon, monster attacks have become a daily occurrence in Ponyville. I mean, after Dragons, Discord, Cerberus, T-Rex, Giant Binds, Giant Sentient Binds.
Ursa Minor, Ursa Major.
Like, the swarm of Paris Sprites, Trixie taking over, it doesn't matter, like, the main six swapping their cutie marks and, wreaking havoc all over the place. It doesn't matter what happens.
They become desensitized.
Yeah. Nothing faces them anymore. So that's why they are so nonchalant about it. It's like, you know what, within the continuity of this show, I kind of appreciate that. Because if I lived in a place like that, once I would have moved after the first bugbear attack. Second, if I kept on living there, it would be like living in Oklahoma. Oh hey, a tornado blew over my house. It's okay, we'll build another one. This is like what, the 10th house we build? It's okay, it's fine. I am going to have every single person in Oklahoma wanting to burn me inside my house now. Oh dear.
But you talk about desensitized. There are spectators to this fight. We go back to a candlelit wedding. If everyone decided to bum rush Chrysalis the moment she revealed herself, how short would that episode have been? So here's these ponies, the main six, now have spectators to their fights. And they're like, where's the popcorn? Why is no one moving through the audience and selling popcorn while we're at it? We might as well. That is the next level to take that desensitization and go a step beyond into commercialization.
Oh, so true. So true.
Hey, well, mate.
You talk about...
Those are the steps.
Main six versus the boogeyman. Get your pamphlets. Get your popcorn. Free drinks. Have a plushie for the kids. There you go, son.
Well, you do say that, but we do see one of the ponies in particular organizing things and sending them left and right. And that's actually the one that Matilda notices. That I think her name is Amethyst Star or something like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think.
And she's the one that is. She appears to be moving characters left and right, saying, "You go there, you go there, you go there." And when Matilda asks her for help, she says, "So I was the best organizer before Twilight came to town. Nobody has asked me for help ever since."
Yeah, that's probably because three winter wrap-ups were late. That's the organization you pulled.
I guess no one likes you,
Amethyst. Ever think of that?
You can do with what you can. And are you talking about this Amethyst or the Steven Universe Amethyst? Because then I will have to fight you. You don't mess with best gem, so.
Oh, wow. I think
we're going to have a conversation about this somewhere else. Because I am going Barnes to... is best gem, first of all.
No.
Okay, you're all wrong there.
anywho, what do I think about this one? Well...
Norman introduces himself into the conversation.
Yeah, I just want a knife fight in the studio. Like, if you want to do it in the car park, please.
Studio? Do we have a studio now? I didn't know that we had a studio. You guys have a studio there? I don't have a studio.
But anywho.
Yeah, why wasn't I invited to the studio?
Because it's 6 feet under.
Well, that is that, Jim. It's that.
Are you drinking?
Probably.
We drove him to drink. Oh, great.
Oh, great. But,
we are so annoying. We turn Norman into alcoholism. That's fantastic.
Oh, wow. My cheeks hurt. Ouch.
What did you think of this one?
This scene here, the whole setup of the ponies in Ponyville desensitized, and it's funny. The line that Sweetie Belle says here is just like, "Billy, be over in half an hour or so." That's how long an episode is. So, yeah. But I have to point something out here. If you take a look, see at the first scene of the main six huddling up, discussing what they need to do, you can see that Cheerly is bringing the students out for a field trip and Big Mac's tagging along. So is the other adults. And you can also see Button Mash there. This, if you guys take a look-see properly, this is just a callback to the fans. A huge callback.
We all know why Big Mac is there, though.
Oh, yeah, we do.
How did I not see
He's
that?
American.
Yep.
Oh, my God, I cannot believe it. I didn't notice that either. You're right.
Yep.
It's and a field trip. Flattened. It is a field trip.
Yeah, so you have to remember that child endangerment, A-OK in Ponyville.
Kids, here you can see our heroes in a Oh, they killed Billy! I think we're gonna need another Billy.
You have to wonder, what? If they're standing there planning, why didn't they just intercept the monster?
I don't know.
Because they've gone so used to the main six doing everything. Oh, the apathy!
Yeah. One thing I also heard that I'm not 100% sure is true or not, that the bugbear here and the color scheme, Hasbro asked them to change it to a panda colored team. From what I heard.
Hasbro. Yeah. Pandering.
Yeah. So, and also if you notice.
Makes me feel better about this knowing that they knew what they were doing.
Yep. Well, I need to talk about that later when we go to the end of the discussion. But yeah. What can I say about this scene? Love it. Just love it. James, what about you, man? Like, I still think we haven't even passed beyond this point. We're still on here, man.
No, it's fine, it's fine. You don't need to hear my opinion on it. I am agreeing with everything that you guys are saying, and whenever you see something negative about it, I can see that, but it's not a deal breaker for me. Like, you know those rose tinted glasses?
Mm-hmm.
I have 7,000 pairs on my eyes while watching this episode. It doesn't matter how many times you remove them, I still have one put on. I mean, I cannot hate this episode despite some flaws here and there. So yeah, no, my opinion is that this is excellent. I am just the moderator. Don't worry about me. So now that we leave the main six fighting this monster as Derpy is trying to figure out what in the world she's going to do to fix her mistake with the invitations. And in a very shouty fashion, Matilda sends her to prepare the flowers, which takes us to the flower trio and
The horror!
Their very, very, very Tumblr ingrained mentality. It's like, we have this minor mistake! Ah!
Oh, wow.
I was so frustrated by these ponies. It's like, what am I watching? Why are they behaving so stupid? I thought they were meant to be cool characters.
Have you not known the Flower Sisters? They're always like this.
Roselock, though.
The Flower Sisters are always like this. They faint at the slightest mishap.
Roselock is the least unstable.
Yes. Roselock has a double fandom
story. She's
usually
the last one to crack.
Yes.
That's a good sign considering the previous reference they made with Roselock and Doctor Who's and Cena. It's like, she's so different between the two episodes. Like, I don't understand.
Yeah, she's almost desensitized. Like, this whole thing, it doesn't faze her. Except a broken Xenia.
Well, flowers are their passion.
Oh, true that, true that.
So they're all the poison ivy of Equestria.
Oh my.
The mortal
now
enemies.
That is something I'd like to see.
Batmare. I like the idea of Poison Ivy. Thank you.
Oh, wow.
Keep on going.
See, now you guys make me want to go back and play Arkham Knight.
Later. But what this brings up a thing where the flowers can't be done today, which is, well, when the wedding is. Because, well, if you know booking and whatnot, they have to get the flowers tomorrow kind of deal. And yeah, you're out of luck, Matilda. There's no flower at your wedding. And here is where Derpy got the idea of, hey, the firework that the doctor has.
You're going too far ahead.
Not really.
No,
this is where she gets the idea, but she doesn't really.
Not yet. She doesn't really say that yet. It will come back later. We go from Derpy being unable to get the flowers to Lila and Bonbon's cameo, but we're not going to talk about that yet. I mean, we haven't heard everyone's opinion in this scene yet anyway. Now, haven't we?
It's a very short scene. It's really a callback to earlier episodes. So again, I think parents and kids will remember it from Applebuck season.
Mm-hmm.
So we're calling way back, four seasons past.
Oh, yes, indeed.
And the bugbear just flies by, and you know, there you go.
I still am amazed at how they don't really care about looking at a monster wrecking or fighting the main six. It's just like an everyday occurrence to them. Like, huh, okay. It's like, hey, that's Batman. Yeah, it's Batman, and look, oh, the Raiders chasing him. Okay. That's something new. So, Billy, how are... Oh, Billy just got run down by a truck. Okay.
Kids getting run over by trucks, dude. You made it weird too. You're all making it weird.
Sorry, I'm just following the tempo.
Billy
got eaten by a mythical creature. That's funny. Billy got hit by a truck. That's tragic.
Oh my God, they killed Billy.
You.
That's not a word.
These three do have had no character developments in season one, but then again, that's the funny part of it. That's what I think works in the scene. So, what makes the scene so funny? They have always been overdramatic, throwing themselves on the ground, unable to do anything, just saying, "It's horrible. This is awful." And we go to the inside of Town Hall, which is where the wedding is going to be celebrating, and we see Lyra and Bon Bon setting up the decorations for it. And these two, if there are characters that have a lot of headcanons built around themselves, in this fandom at least, Vinyl, Scrooge, and Octavia might be number one, maybe, but these two are definitely up there.
Mm-hmm.
And the interpretation that this show does of these two, well, I think there is no other way around it other than comparing it with what we think of these two characters. So what did you guys think of these, and how does it compare to what we are given?
Well, I'm gonna have very little to say here because I've deliberately kept out of the Lyra Bon Bon shipping campaign that seems to cover half of my feeds whenever I go on DeviantArt. But one thing that annoyed me about Hasbro in this particular scene was they were pandering to the names of the ponies, where they obviously had to give her a different name for legal reasons and then calling her Bon Bon in the show because they knew the fans wanted to hear it. And I'm like, great, if you have a legal issue, don't then pander to your fans. It's like, I don't care what you call her. She's for a toy at the end of the day.
Wow.
Like, because it comes up on my feed all the time. Oh, they've changed the names of the ponies for legal reasons. Then why do you then continue to pander the fans on the show by changing the name back and forth? It's like, you can't please everyone. Stop trying. Just do the thing that you need to do.
And let the church say, amen.
Well, like, don't get me wrong, the appearance of the characters was lovely. The relationship was lovely. I think the spy get-up was a little ridiculous, but I enjoyed their appearance. But I just got frustrated at Hasbro for a small moment when I was like, why are you doing that? Why?
Sketch, what do you think, man?
Okay, so we see Lyra and Bon Bon, and we like get a little taste of their dynamic. I personally thought it was kind of funny that they kept emphasizing the fact that they are just good friends. Because, like, I don't know, it might just be me, but I think, like, Hasbro was trying to say, hey, they're just friends. They're just friends. Don't think too hard about it. I was like, yeah, that's real cool. Like, I thought that was funny. But then we get to the part where she says she's a secret agent, and like, my brain goes, hold up, stop. Just stop. Cause the Doctor Who's, bowling alley distraction was one thing, but this is just, I just cannot get behind this. It just, like, I know they wanted to, be quote unquote clever with the whole name change thing, but going about it in this way was just, like, it wasn't even funny. It just made me shake my head and like, why would you do this? This has nothing to do with anything. Like, why?
Smells like anger.
Like, no, I'm indifferent towards Lyra and Bon Bon as far as, fanon is concerned. Like, I'm not really that invested in them. I'm just baffled at the sheer, I don't want to say stupid because that's too harsh. The sheer, like, they had the gall to go that far. I think at that point they were like, okay.
You want to say, if you want to say stupid, say stupid.
And now it's ruined.
If you want to say stupid, don't hold back on
that.
All right.
It was stupid. It was stupid.
It's your opinion after all, but then again, I can see that there is no build up about it, but it's just so out there. It's so weird.
That's the thing. Like, there's such a thing as too weird. Like, because, like, it's definitely okay to go out there and, like, do, like, have a little bit of a twist to surprise the audience and, like, subvert their expectations, if I'm using the phrase properly. But then you get to, like, M. Night Shyamalan levels of like, this twist here, just to put it there.
No, stop right there. Stop right there, criminal scum. You do not use M. Night Shyamalan as a proper way to talk about an episode of this or any other show. We haven't sunk to those levels yet.
Wow.
We're not even touching the surface. We're not even in the same planet. No.
Well, we're on a slippery slope, and we better watch our step before we get to that level.
Oh, I don't think we're going to go that far, but we haven't...
I hope not.
We haven't heard everyone's opinions yet. So, Silver, what do you make of this moment?
Well, I got to get a show of hands here, which will be interesting in the podcast. Who here has seen High School of the Dead?
I heard of it.
I have.
Yep, I have.
I haven't.
Okay, there's... all right. Well, I'm afraid my otaku show during this scene is I was... The first half where they're just talking about how what good friends they are and making eyes at one another and swatting rumps together. Okay, fine. Diamond Tiara and Silver Spoon do that. I'll accept friendship.
I guess it's the same way. It's the same meaning as like bumping shoulders with one of your buddies or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I just having fun with this. But all I was thinking of was a scene in this anime High School of the Dead where two friends are running from the zombies and they're holding hands very delicately and talking about how good friends they'll always be together.
Yeah.
One gets caught, the other and the friend kicks her in the face to make her let go so she can save herself.
Bye-bye.
Only to run smack into a horde of more zombies. So I was thinking, oh God, if this, something like that doesn't happen and you two don't shut up, I'm going to get a cavity. So I actually enjoyed it when suddenly Sweetie drops the disguise. And I'll tell you the greater fiction, stranger than the idea of the secret agent, is that Celestia might actually have some contingencies in place and then might be halfway competent. The joke behind the secret agent thing is how Bon Bon Sweetie Drop's voice keeps changing. She's had like seven. Mm-hmm. And how she basically just blends in with the crowd all the time. So before this episode, Lyra was the most interesting character in the fandom's eyes. She was the one obsessed with humans and her friend, because I can't say Bon Bon Sweetie Drops too many more times without feeling really weird. She was just sort of the long-suffering friend. Well, now the roles have reversed. And I just like, what is going on? And I kind of appreciated the absurdity of it. I can't say it bothered my perception as much.
What can I say about this scene? How to put this? Knowing a bit of why they couldn't call her Bon Bon made it obvious that, hey, it's legal thing. Yeah. So for them to call her Sweetie Drops, well, okay. For toy purposes, I do understand. So, no biggie. Them saying it on the show made me go, what? That was interesting. All right. Carry on. I like where you're going with this. another bugbear attack. Oh, why is Bon Bon acting strange? Oh, she's a secret agent named Sweetie Drops. And activating hidden bag and talking. And in the end, this actually made Bon Bon's character really interesting. And I do like where they're going with it. And if I'm not mistaken, there's a fanfic of that somewhere out there before this happened.
I have to give my 2 cents on this one, because I wasn't expecting this scene to be actually the one that caused this much controversy. Her name is Bon Bon. I love the fact that they were able to use the name Bon Bon in the show. For the longest, I thought they lost the rights for it. And even though it can be considered as like, you know, parody, fair use, whatever, you need to have the script to pass legal in order to use it. Mm-hmm. So, first of all, super happy that they're able to use the name Bon Bon, but even happier that they do something that I have never seen anybody else do. I mean, in a straight face, kind of like fanficky way, I have never seen a fanfic where Bon Bon is the most interesting character than Lyra.
So true.
It's always about Lyra. It's always about Lyra being crazy. It's always about Lyra being unusual and interesting and kind of out there. The one who's obsessed with humans, the one who's obsessed with acting like a human. And suddenly her friend is the one that takes the spotlight. And I'm like, good. Brilliant! I like it. I thought this scene was great, just for the sheer amount of oh my god, what am I watching? Which was that for all the right reasons. I don't have any complaints about this one, however, but I don't know. I'm sorry, Sketchy, but I cannot see from your point of view. I don't think it's that stupid. Like, later on we're gonna see how the episode literally jumps the shark. I think this episode starts with the shark jumped already. It's like it's jumped on a pogo stick with the power of a space shuttle. So
yeah, that's fine. But Silver, see, now that you brought up that whole High School of the Dead thing, now I wish there was a scene where like the bugbear broke in and took one of them and like the other didn't care, like in the slightest. Like see, now you have me rewriting the episode, which I hate doing because I like to look at it for what it is.
Give in to your anger. Feed me your rage.
You, my friend, have a lot of issues.
So I feed on love and you feed on rage. Okay.
Oh, God.
I feed on all manner of fandom outbursts.
Dance, puppets, dance.
Wow. All right.
Cranky is trying to get everything prepared and ready and all that. And we cut right to the spa scene, right?
No, bowling alley.
Bowling alley. Still in the bowling alley. Oh, gosh. Mm-hmm. The episode has been easy to follow up until this point. But, yeah, we go to the bowling alley where Derpy interrupts the doctor. And she's like, I know what I'm going to use instead of flowers. Those flameless fireworks that you had. And he's like, no, wait a minute. You cannot use that. Drops the bowling ball. And he misses. To which John Goodman Pony is like, market zero. I was a bit sad that he didn't go market zero.
But Big Lebowski Pony is having a white Russian.
Yes. That's perfect.
For the kids in the audience, it's milk.
Oh, yes. True that.
We know. Yeah. Oh, we know.
Yeah, milk with what else? I never know what a white Russian is made of.
It is cream, Kahlua, and vodka.
Oh, that's good. So, I just love how the doctor steps out of the bowling alley. He goes, wait a minute, you cannot use the flameless fireworks. I don't know how they set off. My God, is that a bugbear? he's like, oh, look at that. I wasn't expecting to see that today. But no, I really wanted to get to the spa scene. I really wanted to get there because, I don't know. This marks the first time in the history of ever where a YouTube auto caption thing is used as a proper name. And I'm so glad that it said Steven Magnet instead of like Eraser Rubber or something like that. It could have said it could have been so many other names. But it went with Steven Magnet and it stuck. And now it's canon. It's official and it's brilliant. So we see Steven Magnet, the sea serpent, who happens to be a big friend of Cranky Doodle Donkey. Also voiced again by the awesome Lee Toker. And this scene is a mixed bag of a scene. And I think you guys will subscribe to that point because is he likable? Is he hateable? Or is he just so unbearably fabulous? What do you guys think of this guy?
Okay, as a married woman, I have to say I do not like this scene. Because having planned a wedding and been there, I if anyone has said anything like that to me, I don't care if they're the best man, the best friend, or a member of the family, they are getting out. That is so insulting. And I was just, like, I was so excited to see Steven Magnet, but when he said that, I was like, oh my gosh, that's horrible. So I was just, no, you can't say that to someone about to get married, especially when you know what's gone on that day.
To take a page from Seth MacFarlane from the Star Wars parodies that he made, geez, you don't have to be such a...
That's not a word!
Like, I mean, and I'm talking about Steven Magnet, of course.
It's,
he could have
like,
said the I'm... exact same thing without having to sound like such an...
That's not a word!
Like, I don't think, like, if I hadn't been married, I might have found it more funny, but because of my life experience, it was like, you can't, like, how could anybody do that to a married woman on her wedding day? How could anybody do that? It's like, is this meant to be some sort of like American Wedding makeover show joke that I'm not getting?
From all the romantic comedies I see.
Good question. We have two Americans in the show. What do you guys think about this one?
Okay, well, first of all, I'm just glad that we're getting back to the main conflict of the episode, and just like we're starting to like get back into focus here. Yeah, we're starting to get back into the groove here, and I'm seeing like, okay, yeah, they're having a conversation about the wedding. We get to see that Steven Magnet and Cranky have some sort of connection. And going back to the point about like the whole American wedding thing and how much importance people put onto it, I thought playing off of those types of fears was really funny, because like now I'm taking like some outside context into this, because like I have a lot of female relatives and they watch a lot of those wedding shows, like Say Yes to the Dress, and then you see the dudes working there and like they're putting all these fears into these ladies' heads, like, no, this dress has to be perfect. You have to, like, this is your wedding. You want it to be perfect, 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 perfect. And like instilling all those fears into these brides' heads. And I'm like, they're like, it's kind of playing off of that. So like, I kind of had a reminder of those types of moments. So I thought that this kind of moment with Steven Magnet as, I'm not saying it was right for him to do that, but it was definitely funny watching him do it.
What show were you quoting where they're putting the fears in the bride's heads?
Say Yes to the Dress.
Say Yes to the
Dress. Oh God.
Is it one of those reality television shows?
That yes.
Terrible. Yeah, they monopolize the TV sometimes, and I just.
Just watch. I know what you mean, my friend.
Yeah, it's like secondhand watching.
Mm-hmm. You need to improve your diet. You see, you're a bad changeling. You need to watch good shows with love. You don't need to watch bad soap operas and shows that are like.
I'm not trying to watch these shows though. That's the thing. I would like if I had my way, I'd be watching something better right now. If I had my way.
You'd be watching more ponies.
Okay, lesson either one. That get Netflix.
Some, either that two. Or some show that has some form of writing.
Okay, lesson three. Watch Daredevil.
Oh, wow. Silva?
Well, one, I want to see a Cranky Doodle TV show. The dudes wandering around meeting sea serpents. That's like main six. What main six? I have a sea serpent. Your argument is invalid.
So true.
Oh, my.
Your Agumon is invalid.
Your face is invalid.
Oh, wow.
Oh. And now it's on.
Fight.
No, be adults.
Why? If I were, would I be watching the show?
No. So I'm sure you will win anyway. No. Let's not talk about that.
Okay. Look, I am in agreement with Sugar that I did not like Steven Magnet when he said this. I have not seen Say Yes to the Dress, but I do. What he said actually made me think, yeah, at least from an American culture, we have put this horrible stress on a wedding. We just pitch it as the most important day of your life. And I'm sorry to harsh on Candlelight Wedding again, but it would have meant so much if Caden's Shining Armor had just gotten married in the rubble with everyone looking haggard and messed up, because as Matilda says, it's all about the love. Not mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that would be a cool idea.
It would be, but
I'm down to see that.
But here's Steven representing the idea that it has to be perfect because it's for other people. It's a pressure we apply to the couple, mm-hmm. which actually makes weddings one of the most traumatic and stressful events in a person's life.
So true.
And so I just true. So Steven is sort of a mouthpiece for a part of American culture I don't like.
However, you have to consider. Oh, go ahead, sorry.
And I can't speak for other cultures. I don't know how much of an emphasis people put on it across the seas. Mm-hmm. I will say I was on vacation in St. Petersburg and Helsinki and Tallinn, and I saw weddings there, and they looked very similar to American style.
We have to give credit to Steven Magnet, however, because there is one thing that we are forgetting is that not only credit to him, but also credit to M.A. Larson for his writing. they have 22 minutes to cram all of these characters and give all of them some sort of development. And development comes with both flaws and virtues. Stephen Magnet has the flaw that he is too over the top with everything. But later on we're going to see that he's also a generous and a supportive guy, at least with one of the characters.
He means well.
He means well. He's not a jerk. He just has that moment where, you know, he speaks too much. And hey, I can totally relate to that. I speak too much too many times. Shut up.
Raise his hand.
Oh my gosh. But yeah, is that we have to give credit to that. Whether we like it or not, that's a completely different thing. But there is a lot of effort put into giving these characters their own little moment in the spotlight. And Stevens might be the most memorable of the entire episode. If only because the idea, the image of a giant sea serpent, as fabulous as he is, taking a bath while getting a manicure, is just amazing. It's amazing.
Being a freelance photographer, I covered a lot of weddings. And what Steven says here is so true in my eyes. Because, yeah, the marriage is important. It's the beginning, middle, and end of a relationship. But the wedding here, oh my God, being a photographer for almost any kind of wedding I've seen, be it Chinese, Malay, Indian, or even your traditional Christian wedding, it's a stressful true, but it is so important. It is everything. Relatives from around the state or around another country come down just to be there for that one special night. It's just so stressful.
I definitely want to play off of what Silver said about the marriage being about love, because it's definitely something because you don't want your first moments of being together as a married couple to be filled with stress. And I think that whole stress that people put on the wedding kind of contributes to the whole thing of like people getting divorces all the time, just because like they put so much stress on stuff that isn't that important.
Well, there's so many reasons behind that, but let's not touch on it.
Yeah. Well, let's shout it from the rooftops. We've overdone it. There'll always be an element of stress involved in gathering a large group of people for a big event. Mm-hmm. That is unavoidable.
Because people.
Yeah, true.
Exactly. But to have the most expensive dress, to not be allowed to laugh off when things go a little crazy, to feel like if this doesn't go well, the marriage itself won't go well, that is unreasonable pressure that we put on.
So I do understand what you mean. And sometimes it's not on the bride and groom. Sometimes it's on the parents. Sometimes on the relatives.
I think we are losing focus on something. Okay, I'm going to tell an anecdote right now. It has nothing to do with me. This didn't happen to me. This happened it was so important that it actually made national news here in Spain. There was a couple that were getting married, and they hired a photographer to take the pictures of their wedding. And the photographer, he went and lost all the pictures. All of them. Like, he didn't have the backups, anything. He said that there was a computer virus that took all of the photographs down, and he lost all of them. And the couple sued him for the cost of the wedding and an extra charge for damages. And I can totally see that, and I can actually defend that. Because losing the photographs of an event that cannot be repeated and cannot be recreated, something that is life-changing, that is basically bonding your life to someone that you love, that is something that cannot be repeated. That's something that has to go right from the get-go. Yes, that's why you have rehearsals, that's why you have setups, that's why you have to make sure that everything goes right. Because if something goes wrong, that's what people are going to remember. How wrong that one thing went. True. So, what Stephen Magnet says is true. The way he says it is wrong.
It's very
mean. He is too, too D. dickish about it. But I can understand that because that's the personality that he has. That's how he is. And I am going to sound like a total...
That's not a word!
...right now, but it's a personality that is very akin to how gay people were written in the 90s. He has a total 1997 gay friend personality going on right there.
Yeah, I didn't want to say it, but yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't want to be the one to drop that bomb.
No, don't worry. That's what I'm here for. I put myself in the target.
I was really worried I'd have to make the PewDiePie reference with the, oh, so fabulous. But there, thank you for putting it out there.
Well, I opened the floodgates.
Finger
here
snap,
we go.
Finger snap.
PC out the window.
I actually disagree with you, James, on the wedding thing, but that's fine. We're not meant to agree on everything. But
true.
I'm a married woman. I've been there. Mm-hmm. I planned and organized my wedding. But what, if people tried to put pressure on me for it, but ended up putting pressure on themselves because I was like, no. The only thing that mattered to me was the fact that I'm marrying the stupid-faced idiot that's sitting across the room from me. Because, at the end of the day, like Silvercross says, it's there for love. If I had not got the photos, I don't care, because on that day, I got to look in his eyes, and I will remember that moment the rest of my life, and just hear the words, I do. And that's
love is not going to get you back 30,000 euros you spent on a service that you were not given.
Yeah, so true.
Well, hey, difference between losing a service and having a bad experience.
That's what the lawsuit was for, as well as, damages.
But you said the lawsuit was for the entire wedding.
No, that's
the
what
lawsuit
they
was for the lawsuit was for losing the photographs and being unable to recreate them.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay.
Because it's something that happened once. It cannot happen again.
Fair enough, but you made it sound like you said they were charging him, they were suing him for the cost of the whole wedding, not just the photography service.
Oh, actually, they were charging him for more than that. They wanted to charge him for like 1 million euros worth of damages. And
where I call baloney.
I gotta draw the line there.
The judge didn't give them that, but they gave, he gave them 100,000 euros. In damages.
Wow.
Because the law actually protects you for that. If you have a case for it and if you know how to present it, Spanish law will back you up on that. Moral of the story, back up!
True.
Or else you will get into trouble. This is why I have two hard drives and my internal hard drive as backups for all my drawings. But after freaking out, Matilda, we cut to the musicians preparing their instruments and all that, and they both live together in a house that is divided. Literally. Electronic music on one side, classical music on the other. And I do wonder how their daily life is in a house like that. It's like the phone's ringing, yes, but it's on your side. I don't want to touch that. Can you get me something from the fridge? It's on your side. Yeah, but I'm sitting down. I don't want to get up. You go get it. I don't want to.
Do you think Vinyl Scratch actually has the dishwasher on her half? You know,
I'm pretty sure she does. I'm pretty sure Octavia didn't allow her to tune up the
clean
the
it with wubs.
Fun fact about this scenario here: from what I understand of what Larson said in things that got cut out from the initial cut, that this was supposed to be 100% Vinyl's house, and Vinyl just crashes in. This was not supposed to be, yet it is. So that's cool.
Wait, I'm sorry. You said Vinyl twice. Is it supposed to be Octavia's house?
Octavia. Wait, sorry, Octavia's place. Sorry.
Okay. Okay. We're all clear now. We're all friends here. Let's not let someone else's wedding tear us apart.
Let me just get that address, though.
I'm not friends with you anymore, though. Norman. I hate you. I hate you.
Oh, wow. It is just like a wedding.
What does this button do?
But, yeah, and you know what? I could actually see how this was meant to be just Vinyl's house. Octavia's house.
Mm-hmm.
Weird, because we have always seen Octavia hanging out in Canterlot. And to think that she actually has a house in Ponyville, that actually is kind of interesting. Why would she move to Ponyville out of all places when she is so classy? You could argue the same thing about Rarity and why she's still in Ponyville, but Rarity was born in Ponyville. What is Tabby doing there? Anyway, Octavia is trying to come up with something good for the wedding, something interesting, something better than those boring-sounding wedding songs. So Vinyl jumps right in and starts wobbing the horse apples out of the out of the songs. Yep, in yep. I have to, and this is my favorite scene of the entire episode, by the way. So the remix and the testing and the trying new things turns into a two-sided battle between the both of them. Two-sided musical battle. What did you guys think of this scene?
I love this scene, but not because of the music, although I do love the music. I love this teeny little interaction you get between the two of them before they start the battle, where you see them, they're trying to integrate, and that little moment where Tabby sort of looks at her and says, like, no, that's not gonna work, and you just, that little moment where she's like, no, we'll just leave it, it's fine, I'll get it done, before the click. Like, I just like that teeny little interaction that makes all the difference to their relationship. It's like she almost gave up on her friend, and her friend was like, no, watch this, and gets it. It's like that little moment made that scene for me. I loved seeing that interaction between the two. And then obviously you have, like, you don't see that. Like, you think with relationships, like, everyone's like, oh, these guys are in sync, they're gonna make, like, an awesome tune. But no! Tabby's not actually that in sync with Vinyl, but Vinyl's in sync with Tabby. I like that. And then, obviously, when you get the beats, it's really quite cool, and I do like that. The drop the bass, and then it's like, oh, wait, no, don't drop the bass. I need the bass to work for the wedding. I like that. I like that.
From an animation standpoint, this scene is also remarkable. I think it is so smooth, and it is so energetic. Like, there is a lot of kinetic energy going on in this scene. But, yeah, they are about to smash instruments between each other. Don't read too much into that. they realize, oh, hang on a minute, we're gonna be late for the wedding! Q bursting through the door, riding the... Well, there is no other way we can put it. They're riding the bass cannon. they're basically riding the bass cannon.
Oh, wow.
In order to make it in time to the wedding. At the same time as they are still playing their instruments and jumping over the shark. And I'm like, Larson, that was fun. You guys jumped the shark from like, one of the episodes.
What is a shark doing there?
It's there just to be jumped.
Oh, wow.
Which,
but, you know,
you know, visual representations of moments that are happening on a TV show rarely work. Hell, even when Arrested Development did it, kind of like was weird. Like, you saw that scene where the Fonz actually jumps the shark again in Arrested Development. That was odd.
Yeah.
Well,
it's
so what? Yeah, it's like having Rick Astley break into the middle of a parade singing "Never Gonna Give You Up." So, which also, by the way, it happened. So, what did you guys think of this? And now, like, seriously, shark jumping thoughts. Sugar.
Well, I think we skipped a lot of people talking about Tabby and Vinyl.
Mm-hmm. We did. Okay,
it's cool. We could probably talk about the entire thing because, like, sequence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
we don't mind.
Good moderator. You might have noticed that now. Sorry,
you're fired.
Yeah, you skipped like three people.
Yeah. But anyway, Sugar, jumping shop scene, and then we carry on.
There were so many cameos in that little sequence. Like every 2 seconds, I was like, oh, I recognize that one, and that one, and that one, and that one. And I was too busy trying to count the ponies that I recognized that I wasn't taking in much else.
I thought it was cool the way Octi and Vinyl's house was designed. Like, the way it is designed, you'd think there were two houses. I kind of like that even though they live together, they don't have, like, 100% synergy, but they work on it, you know?
Mm.
And you see them adjust to each other's groove, and they find a balance, and then that's when the music starts to get good. And then like it's a good track, man. I'm just bopping my head to it. I'm just like jamming out internally. And then I think the jam out sequence went a little bit too long. Like at a certain point I felt like, okay, now you're just filling up time. Like, can we move along? Yeah, and then when they get out to the base cannon mobile, they're cruising down the street in their 6-4. They go and I see them just jump going around, and like now this is the part where they just throw every reference at the wall and see how many we can get. And I wasn't too excited by it. Like, I'm not gonna say that I didn't like it. But I was just like, okay, it's just happening, and I just like watched it emotionlessly, like just observing it, like, okay, this is going on. I see that. I get that reference. Okay, what's next? Then we get to the part where we get to the wedding, but that comes up next. So.
Yo, you are going a bit too far again.
Yeah. Yeah. So on to the next person.
That would be me. All right. Going back to, you know, would this meet the three audiences? Yes. This is probably the best scene. At least the house and the musical remix. You don't have to know squat. They tell you everything you need to know with just the shot of that house. Dual mm-hmm. natures, split viewpoints, but they're still friends because they're living together. Mm-hmm. And they're finding the balance or the compromise between two extremes. And this great remix that I found catchy, I really enjoyed. And they both get into it, again, to the point where they nearly destroy their own instruments. So you don't have to know the fandom interpretation. You don't have to have seen past episodes. Everything you need to know is contained right there, visually, in dialogue, and in music. It's all there. And I thought that was phenomenal. Now, I got a kick out of seeing them go through the town and pick up every second-tier character, third-tier, actually, third-tier character along the way. All these callbacks, all these references. It's good they got to button mash, because both he and the video game were about to get a cease and desist order, and they could have been in that episode if they'd been a second later. Sorry, too soon? So
can we talk about the
always,
beginning that
some,
he's
for
playing?
For some people, it's always too soon.
Let's talk about the video game he's playing for a moment, because it's a Salt Lick video game.
What? Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Really?
Yeah, you have to be as inappropriate as possible with it.
I thought he was using...
It's the new... I thought it was a microphone, but somebody brought it up, and it is a Salt Lick video game.
Oh, God.
It's the new Salt Cube system, don't you know? There'll be like 5 good games on it, and then they'll ditch it for the Wii U.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Yeah.
That Super Mario Sunshine was pretty good.
Then there was that think of an Xbox reference I can make.
Then there was that pod racing game, which...
Where's Midnight Scribe when you need him?
The jelly pony, to see him send the jar. That was fun. I like seeing all these characters assembling, because when you go to any event, any public mm-hmm. place, everybody's got a story.
Oh, yeah. Huh?
And one of my big critiques of My Little Pony is that it's so focused on the main 6, you kind of neglect the world. And we're curious. This fandom makes these backstories for background characters because we're curious about the world. And it feels like it's for so long, it's felt like a missed opportunity, to not let these other characters interact with our main heroines. Now, more recent episodes in season 5 have begun to lighten up on this and to allow the rest of the world to have an impact. And mm-hmm. I think that's a very healthy progression for the story. Because good knows we're going to run out of ideas for the main 6 if they keep this pace up.
So true.
Wait until we get to Amanda in Faces. The offenses. That is going to be an interesting.
Yeah, game. I'm gonna have to make a note about that, because I want to bounce off of that when we get to the end.
Mm. Okay, but so to see all these characters that within the show have little to no characterization, but within an online fandom. Are in some ways more fun than the main 6 because people can make these characters. It's fun just to see that kind of homage. You throw in Twyla Kane, I get a good laugh because I promised Twilight Kane would return in one of my videos. But you're also like, oh, yeah, I see what you did there. I have a Twilight Kane trading card on my shelf. But there is one critique I have of the fandom. I think it's a mistake for us to think that the fandom as a collective is an unnamed writer for the show. This episode is this great send-up to the energy the fans put forth, but we don't have a say in what's canon, how these characters interact. It's great that they're giving some validity to it, but I think some people might take it the wrong way and think our word is now law.
So yeah, that's the once you side. Give people a little taste of power.
Yeah, this is the other side of the coin, and I made it heavy.
No, I'll try to lighten it back up, because the dueling musicians, they're awesome. Like, the beginning was a bit rough, but when they got the groove, it was awesome. And, well, Tina Guo, who played the cello for this one, did a really, really good job for it. This was, what, way back in, let me see, April? That wording was coming out about Will Anderson finished recording with Tina for most of the cello part. And wow, this was pretty awesome. Like, why you felt long, sketchy, because they brought up big bucks for this. So they're going to milk it as far as they can.
Make them get their money's worth?
Yes, indeed.
I can understand that from a financial standpoint, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and well, jumping on the base cannon mobile, they picked up almost everyone they needed to go to the wedding. Because if you take a look, I find this interesting. The first people or the first pony that they picked up was Jelly Pony, Disco Pony, and Button Mash. And this tree was introduced during Hearts and Hooves Day. And the next ponies to be picked up is who's that pony? The delivery
Pokey
pony.
Pierce.
Yeah, and Pokey Pierce and the delivery ponies. They're all trying to group every pony together. Like, that cameo made sense. Like, you have Devonport with the delivery, delivering the sofa to any pony that they needed to deliver to. And, well, it's fun. This whole scene was fun. Twilight Kane did make a cameo. And, well, James, what do you think, man?
The order in which the ponies are picked up makes kind of sense. I mean, and all of them are actually characters that have appeared in the background in season 1 and 2. Probably some of those that have been appreciated by the fans the most. I mean, you have Minuit, Colgate, you have Berry Punch holding the barrel of cider with her, of course. The delivery horse with Davenport, Sofa, and Dewdrop Dazzle. Those are the Dewdrop Dazzle and the delivery pony are the ones that appear on the Feeling Pinky Keen episode. Mm-hmm. Right when Twilight is getting all the stuff drop on her face. Filthy Rich is there for some reason, which is hilarious. I love the way that Filthy Rich just appears out of nowhere.
He has money, don't question it.
So true.
Doesn't need to make sense.
It needs to make dollars.
And they pass by so fast that they blow the toupee off of Cranky, mm-hmm. make it fly away. And it is the Twilight Kane that makes them lose balance, break, and sends them flying off. As we zoom all the way back to the most philosophical character the show has ever had.
Who would have expected that Gummy to have the most, philosophical mind in the show?
I honestly love that scene because I was just dying of laughter. Like, especially after several minutes of just like dead humor for me. Like, up to this point, a lot of the jokes leading up to it were just not funny for me, but then we get here and we hear his whole philosophical spiel, and because like it's such a huge contrast to what we thought, that it's like, wow, this is really funny. Like it kind of reminded me of how in the comics we find out what Big Mac is thinking all the time. hearing what he has to say about things. So it kind of reminded me of that and seeing, like, it makes me wonder how much has he observed and what observations has he made about those things.
I didn't know whether I should find it funny or start philosophizing with him. It's like, I'm ahead. Oh, what's happening?
You could do both.
Oh, it's bad when you come out of uni and you're still in uni mode and you hear something like that and you're like, wow, that's so deep. What does that mean? I'm so confused about the meaning of my security mark now. I just don't know what to think.
Silver, let's hope you have an answer.
I nearly quit the fandom. I was like, I can't top that. It's beyond me. This is the end of my reviewing career. I can't top that. Good night, everybody. Bye.
Goodbye.
And now I shall take the throne.
Oh, no.
But then I realized I'm not the reviewer this fandom deserves, but I'm the one it needs. Or is it the other way around? Dang it. I don't know if there's any way to comment on that other than, ironically, it sets up for party poops. Everyone has dismissed
Pinkie Pie. Oh my god, it does.
Everyone has dismissed Pinkie Pie as an idiot or a lunatic, and here she is putting so much work into Oh, yes? You raised your hand.
People have been dismissing Pinkie Pie. I'm guilty.
I don't know how to do this without making it sound like I'm calling people out. I was on a different podcast way back when.
How dare you?
I dare because I can.
It's okay, I'm joking.
I've been playing you the whole time, baby.
No, but I thought we had something.
We were talking about testing 1, 2, 3, and there was the debate over the main six teaching styles, and this one other reviewer was instantly dismissing Pinkie Pie based on that she's an idiot and all of her teaching methods, even though I think musical rhymes are a good way to learn. And so I've sort of carried that with me into Party Pooped and by semi-extension Slice of Life, where not only does Pinkie put a lot of hard work and organization into her efforts, her pet is deeper than he appears, and I know I'm assigning a lot of meaning to this. Basically, there's a lot going on under the surface with both of them that people just make assumptions about. And that's what makes her and Gummy a fun character, but also what makes this scene so hilarious.
May I remind you the MLP comic with the pets? I'm swimming, I'm gonna screw you, checkmate.
Oh wow. I just don't know what to say about that. The whole scene, Gummy here.
It makes sense within the character.
Well, at least in the future, we now know that whatever Pinkie does, he'll just overthink it. That'll be something interesting to see.
It might. Well, thankfully, they all fall inside the... Oh, have we all said what we think of the...
Yeah, we did.
So they all fall inside the town hall, seat prepared, all ready to go ahead with the wedding. As Octavia is happy with the result of the whole thing. And then we see that also Princess Celestia and Princess Luna have been invited to the wedding, and oh, whoop-de-dee-doo, they actually have sisterly interaction.
I like this.
Be careful, Celestia. Last time you disagreed with your sister, there was like a giant battle. Elements of harmony had to be used. I couldn't fight with Luna too much.
But Luna's reaction. Luna's sisterly reaction. Now, as the oldest of three, I love watching my two youngest sisters because, like, they're so different. Megan really behaves like Celestia in that scene. She's like, it's your fault that this has gone wrong. It's your fault. And I like that Luna's just like, yeah, yeah, whatever you say. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's so what a little sister would do. I love it.
Man, I've been waiting to talk about this scene for, like, since we started, because this is, for me, the best scene in the entire episode. I love the heck out of this scene. And it made me disappointed that we couldn't see more, because, like, this is a side of Celestia and Luna that, up until this point, we've only seen in the comics. You know, we don't really get to see them act as sisters. And I thought it was really cool to see that, that we got to see another side to them. And I was hoping that we get a little bit more of that.
I say that we're finally getting to see Luna and Celestia be relatable characters, no longer held up as paragons. You know, Dr. Wolf and Josh, Commander Firebrand, they had this big talk about ideal role models. But I think you got to stress the human aspects of them. And you finally get to see these two behaving like siblings, that it's not perfect, that they have bad days. And especially with Celestia, you know she loves you when she's willing to be less than perfect, when she's willing to get upset or frustrated.
This scene, when it was first brought up, like, oh my, Celestia and Luna, squee, they're in the same page, finally, yay!
Same page, Norman, this is well, a same, TV same show, what are you talking
about? Same scene, come on, same scene. But anyway, it was so much fun to see them, and oh my god, they're interacting. What? They're bickering. They're fighting about the present. Oh my goodness, this is something we do not expect to see this in the show. IDW comic, probably, but not in the show. And I want to see more of this in the future. Like, I don't mind seeing an episode of them just derping around, just probably arguing about chores or who left this toilet seat up. That's just much fun for me.
Okay, that, why?
Norman, and your adventures.
Why not?
Thank God you're not the writer for the show.
We are getting into imagery I'd rather not.
Oh,
I don't want to think on the princess in the toilet, Norman.
There's a fanfic about that.
Okay, look, I know the princess in the pee is a popular story, but I think you're misinterpreting.
Oh God, ow. Ow.
Okay. Stop. Okay. Stop.
I'll stop. But James, what about you, man?
What about me? Sunshine and Moonbeams is no canon.
Yeah, that's all it I have is. To say. I love that.
Okay. So, can we please talk about the scarf now? Can we please talk about the scarf?
Actually, we need to talk about Liquid Pride.
Yeah, we're getting too far ahead of
us. Oh, yes, Liquid Pride.
Yeah, I am most impressed that, oh my god, you guys are actually having some development. It's tiny, it's microscopic, but there's more to you than just love.
I don't know why. Okay, this scene to me in my head is a lot of fun. Like seeing, oh, they're so cute, they're just together. But I don't know why Shining is crying. Like, why I'm just confused. No, I don't know, I'm just confused in my head.
Strong man! Also cry.
I like that it's normally he cries when the wedding starts. It's like, how many weddings have they been to?
Well, Princess of Love, I imagine she's had to preside over more than a few.
True.
Also, have any of us
hold up, though. What, think about this, though. What if he cries at weddings because he has PTSD from his own?
Oh my gosh!
Oh god!
You're saying that right now Shane Armour is having one of those Vietnam flashbacks back to a Canterlot wedding?
Yes, he is.
You know what? I have those as well. Those episodes were awful. Horror.
I think he's just realized how useless the Royal Guard is, because not only is he there and not fighting the bugbear, apparently Celestia has a secret service in place of the Royal Guard. He's just realized his entire life is a lie.
Maybe he also realized that he doesn't have any character to him whatsoever. My character has no depth.
Oh, don't be mean.
Well, there is one thing about Crying Shining that fits with the overall show. We have this running joke of, you know, the boys acting more what people would call effeminate. You've got Spike and his 6-hour bubble baths.
Wow.
You have shining armor crying at weddings, and the knight in shining armor always needs saving. But all of that pales in comparison to bulk biceps. The most macho of guy who is terrified of butterflies, likes wearing frumpy, ugly dresses, and is a very disturbing masseuse.
Ouch.
Like Kanji from Persona 4.
There you go. So I'm going to say yes, you youngin. And I just like, yeah, at some point you're like, okay, show, you've had like 3 to 4 male characters, well, Steven Magnet, 4 to 5, that defy gender expectations. When are you going to have one that gets just to be a consistent character?
Well, you do have Filthy. He's consistent.
What about Spike?
6-hour bubble bath, likes to wear frilly aprons mm-hmm. with hearts on them.
What about Discord?
I'm not.
Discord is Discord.
Tea parties.
Have you not? Ed, Princess Discord. That's all I got to say. I don't think.
And that maid outfit in the beginning of season 4.
Oh, oh god. Yeah. Oh, I'm having a little PTSD now.
Oh god.
DeviantArt went crazy that day.
Well, he doesn't do Windows.
I'm just saying, we've seen this manner of joke many a time. Shining Armor's often the target of it. It's funny, don't get me wrong, I get a good laugh, but I also like, okay, guys, I need something more.
I'm pretty sure you would like it more if it was Flash Sentry.
Oh, wait, you've opened the gates. One of the cutting.
What have you done? What have you done?
Oh, you don't. I pulled the string. Pull the string.
No, one of the cutting room floor ideas was Flash Sentry making an appearance, following Cranky around, saying, "Why doesn't anyone like me?"
You know why people don't like you, Flash. Don't act like you don't know.
Oh, but that was just mean-spirited, to be honest.
Killer.
That was just mean-spirited. That was just not nice. But it was a fun idea to be placed in it.
They couldn't use him. They did use him in the comics, though, although they gave him way too much dignity.
but it's...
You know what? Okay, I will say one thing. You know why they use Chain and Armor? You know why they put him on these situations and they usually put him as the bottom of, as the butt of all jokes?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's fun.
Oh, true that.
It's fun to have the tough guy or the apparent tough guy, captain of the guard and all that, be a play toy. Because he pretty much is a play toy.
Yeah, but Bulk Biceps, who's even more macho, does the job better in my eyes.
Because it's a lot funnier to see the guy, the culturist guy, be afraid of tiny little butterflies. Although I have to admit, I'm not very partial to moths either. Like, don't trap me and a moth in a room. I will turn into a 1920s housewife.
Wow.
Eek.
Yes.
Either that or Shia LaBeouf. I will turn into
what, just do it?
Yeah.
But the next scene here is Derpy setting up the flower placement, and it looks pretty. And Bon Bon announcing that, hey, the main six has defeated the bugbear. Yay! And going up to Lyra and just talking to her about, well, her secrets and whatnot, and asking for apologies.
And you know those hands? I cooked them up and ate them. I mean, oats, yeah. No hands.
Lyra, that kills people.
Oh, no, not that. Don't reference that.
No, please. The timing and the way that it was put together, it was a direct callback. I'm telling you. I cooked them up and ate them. All of them. The time difference fits. That was back in 2013. They could very well have done it.
No, I don't think so. I don't think Larson's that sadistic. But no, Sugar, what do you think, man?
I don't think I... Like, honestly, there's only two things in this whole sequence I have anything to say about, and it's not them. Because, like, I love the little interactions, I enjoyed it, but there's nothing significant to me about these interactions yet, because we all know who I'm waiting to talk about.
Oh, alright.
Well, I don't get involved with Lyra Bon Bon. It's one of, like, this, like, Tavi Vinyl I've looked into, and Celestia Luna I've looked into, but I've never looked at Bon Bon and Lyra as a relationship, so I don't have a lot to comment on when it comes to those two.
When I see Lyra and Bon Bon coming again, I'm like, oh god, we're gonna address this again? I was just, like, dreading the whole conversation, so I was just, like, sitting there watching it, and I'm like, okay, let's get to the next part, because I don't want to be reminded of the Agent Bon Bon thing.
Alright. And Silva?
Well, like I say, Lyra's the boring one in the relationship now. It was just sort of resolution. We're coming to the end. Everyone's got to be happy and reunited. So, and it's so good that friends can share and be open about their past now. And then Bon Bon says, "Oh, by the way, I killed 3 ponies." It was for Princess and Country.
I think it's a very funny scene. That's it. What else do you want me to say?
It's kind of skippable.
I like that they do give resolution, they give closure, and that's one thing that this episode does, is that it closes all the stories that it starts, leaves no hanging threads, and it gives all the characters a resolution. And I think that, are we talking about the Lyra and Bon Bon scene, or can we talk about every little scene that is had prior to the speech that Mayor Mare gives at the end of the wedding?
Yeah, you can see.
Isn't the speech next? Or
because we are forgetting to talk about Cranky and Stephen Magnet talking with each other, and how Cranky is mad that he lost his toupee, and how Stephen Magnet makes a direct callback to episode 2 of season 1, and removes half of his mustache just so Cranky can have a toupee to have his wedding with, and what a nice guy! And that's what it says, is that that's what it shows, is that he is a good guy. He is not without his flaws, but he means really good, and he does support his friend. So yeah, in 22 minutes, they managed to get, and not only that, but that happens with every character that is presented here. It goes with Derpy, it goes with the Doctor, it goes with Lyra and Bon Bon, with Stephen Magnet, of course. We see more of Cranky and Matilda. We know what that Cranky is, a bit stiff when it comes to giving money and paying for things, but he does want to have the best wedding with his lovely one. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So in 22 minutes, they managed to flesh out, what, 10 plus characters? How is that possible? How did they do that?
I don't know, but that scarf.
Okay. Yeah. I would argue that, like, not a lot of them are fleshed out.
Well, probably. I mean, they have to keep something for the future, right?
There's more to come.
Mm-hmm, true that. And talking about resolutions, well, looks like the Doctor didn't get that sleeve fix. Instead, comes in with a scarf.
The Tom Baker scarf.
It was so worth following him for all that time.
Yeah.
As a Whovian, that's a big deal. But there's two moments in this entire wedding sequence that are important to a Whovian, and I want to get them out of my system so I can concentrate on the Hell of VW bit that's coming. Mm-hmm. But one, there's the scarf. Now, for anyone that's being a long-term fan, that's a big deal, because it's literally the icon that people recognize as Doctor Who. Or at least in the UK, that's what we recognize as Doctor Who's icon. And then there's a little moment at the end where obviously things go off and he gets excited, but do you notice who he's sitting next to?
Rose Luck,
yeah.
We already know in previous episodes that he's going out with Rose Luck with 3D glasses, and that's already a shout out to Whovians, but to see her sitting there is like, ooh, Doctor and Rose are together at the loveliest moment in the episode.
Together for the third time in the show.
Yay.
Like, I like that little detail, I like little details, and that's just a little moment, and I think, right, that's me, that's all my fandom stuff gone, that's all my happy stuff out of my system. There we can focus on the lovey part.
Yeah. And, well, as the wedding is about to proceed, Mare asks, is everyone ready? And, well, Derpy being Derpy says yes, and denies access to the main 6.
Freaking scene stealers.
Denied.
Denied. So this speech here is wonderful, and I wish I remember the line, but
everyone has their own story.
Yeah, that line was the whole sentence, that whole thing. That was good. That was awesome. And how they pen to each and every character from
every character is the protagonist of their own story. But it's not just the main characters that make their own our story, but the little ones. I like that message, actually. That is a very good one. It's like, even the smallest people in your life can make a difference. Mm-hmm. Don't underestimate the little guys.
I enjoyed the message because it was definitely something that not only viewers can learn, but writers can learn too. That it doesn't always have to be about the main characters. You can take some time and flesh out the side characters, because at that point, now you have a more developed world. Now this feels like a place where you can go and you can interact with everyone, because it feels like everyone is an actual, for lack of a better word, person. So while the speech itself, like, it kind of borderline, it kind of like walked that thin line between teaching and spoon feeding. I think the overall delivery, I think, was good enough to get the message across.
It's the message that, funny enough, Princess Spike failed to convey adequately in the very next episode.
Aww. Can we not talk about that?
Oh, we're going to talk about it.
Everybody hating on the Spike episodes.
It felt like more of the same to me, and that's why I was bored.
This discussion on next episode, but I'm getting sick and tired of people hating on the Spike episodes because they are about Spike.
I'm tired
of that. I
like Spike. I just didn't like that episode.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, Spike has some great episodes. Like, Inspiration Manifestation is one of my favorites of season 4, maybe the entire series.
Oh, you say Spike episode? That was a rarity episode. I don't know who that was. Spike in that episode?
No, it was Spike that was having the conflict, though. I would say it was a Spike episode.
I don't know who is this Spike you're talking about. I only remember
the episode. Oh, you. But anywho, as the speech is given, we see them pan across each character. And yeah, the infamous changeling. Sketch, what do you know of him? Are we supposed to be afraid of him?
No, that's my little cousin. He's harmless.
Oh, right, okay. And
I shall call him George.
Funny, that's his name.
Oh, wow. And as the mayor announces that, Matilda and Jack and Jenny, they kiss, and the flowers explode into a wonderful fireworks of... That's not safe. I just have to say, that's just not safe.
Nothing.
Things that happen in this show, you're going to say that that's not safe?
Yeah.
Fireworks in a confined space?
They're fireless fireworks. It's fine.
You know what's funny? I recently...
Covered their tracks from the get-go.
Also, I recently saw beef-free ground beef at a grocery store. What? So fireless fireworks are no longer the strangest thing I've ever heard.
Okay.
Maybe they're made with soy too.
Oh God, I don't know. And
gross.
You don't want that.
But anyway, they end the scene with the main six. Well, showing the main six looking in and being, how do I say this? They enjoyed the wedding from the outside, and now they're the background characters and end scene. So that was a slice of life. What did everyone think?
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it as for what it was. I don't want to take little bits out and nitpick it. I just, like, I like sitting down and having something enjoyable and friendly and happy, and it was really nice just to have something that was friendly and happy and fresh on a Saturday evening when you get home.
Well, like, again, there was, like, a little bit more bad for me than good, because, like, it's not that I'm trying to, like, analyze it or look at it seriously, because, like, even when I look at it with just a casual viewpoint and just try to, like, take the humor as it comes, a lot of the humor just fell flat for me, save for the couple of moments that I liked with, like, Celestia and Luna and Gummy and other points that I mentioned. Cause like there was some stuff that was like either it dragged on or it was like why is it here? With all that being said though, I'm not gonna go and say that I hate this episode because there were things about it that I did like. I wouldn't find myself going back to rewatch it, and I will say that it is one of the weaker episodes of the season for me, but there are definitely episodes out there that I think are less enjoyable than this. Because it does have its merits. So while I'm not as enthusiastic about it as other people are, I'm not going to go ahead and praise it as an immaculate piece of work. There are still bits and pieces. Like, I would fast forward through everything and rewatch the stuff that I like.
Still, we are sending our thugs your way. Please don't move. Wait for the beating to come to your house.
Hey, that's not nice. Silver, what do you think?
Well, echoing my thoughts from the beginning of this review, which is like 2 hours ago, I think.
Yeah.
Call-outs and shout-outs to your fans can make an episode a lot of fun, and this episode was a lot of fun to watch. In terms of, it's not the most tightly met, it doesn't generate as many feels as some episodes may, but as just entertainment and fun, it's a wonderful experience for me. But I do admit to a little sadness at the end as we shift the focus back to the main six, because you kind of feel like, oh, these characters are going to go back to being in, well, background. We may not get to see the Doctor involve the main six in his mad schemes or witness secret agent Sweetie Drops coming to them for a special assignment. There's so much that you could actually carry forward, and in a funny way, Amending Fences did tap into this a little bit better.
Yeah.
But it's a wonderful time, but I'm almost like, oh, this show, I'm not asking that the show involve all these characters again and again, but you can do more with this world.
I think that we have been talking about this episode for too long, and we should wrap it up.
Well, there is one point that I wanted to say about one part that was ended up being left out that I'm really sad that it wasn't put into the episode. There was supposed to be a scene where Celestia's guards and Luna's guards are making impressions of the princesses.
Yeah, that one.
And I'm why didn't you not put that in the episode? Like, I legit got, like, I almost got upset. Like, cause like, I can think of like several scenes that could have been taken out from the episode in place of the Royal Guard scene. I'm like, why did you, I almost cried. Like, I'm on the verge of tears right now. Like, why did they not put it in the episode?
Oh, that would be fun to see. That would be fun to see. But, Hasbro has their ways of doing things, and probably for the best.
Tattoo.
Yeah, true. But anywho, we've been rambling on for way too long. But anywho, James, what next week's thing is going
to
be?
We're going to be reviewing episode 10 of season 5, titled Princess Spike, overall episode number 101, written by Neil Dusedo, and storyboard with story by Jason Thiessen and Jim Miller. Can this little guy follow up after this massive episode landmark? We will have
Green to wait and see.
We'll have to wait and see then.
That will be a review for another time. Thank you guys so much for watching this out, or listening to us, of course. There was no visual anyway. And we hope to see you on the next review. Have a good one, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Adios.
Later.
Of course, not even in episode 100 we can get a break from the stupid sound box. Oh my god.
I missed it, baby.
I don't.